Hello and welcome to South to North, bringing you the voices of the Global South from Johannesburg, South Africa. Now, do you ever gaze at the stars and wonder how it all began and whether there is life out there? If so, the answers may come from unexpected quarters. Money is being pumped into space exploration in countries like China and India. And here on this continent, South Africa recently won a bid to co-host the world's largest radio telescope, a project that could see Africa emerge as a leading global science frontier. Eager to find answers to some of astronomy's long-standing mysteries, top scientists and engineers from all over the world are flocking to the continent. So what discoveries do they have in store for us? And how will the region benefit as a whole? In the studio, I have with me Square Kilometer Array Research Chair, Professor Oleg Smirnov from Russia, Chinese-American astrophysicist Dr. Xing Cynthia Chang, and development expert Fumani Mtembi. All of you, welcome to South to North. Professor Oleg, let's start with you. Break this down for us. What is the SKA?
The SKA will be a massive array of radio telescopes with the total area is a square kilometer, hence the name. It's going to be the world's biggest and most sensitive radio telescope, more sensitive by a huge margin over anything we have right now. And I think it's going to provide us with some fantastic new science.
You look very excited about it. Why should we be excited?
I think, well, astronomy fundamentally tells us about our place in the universe and what that universe looks like. So being able to find out more about that, I think, is fantastic for humanity as a whole.
Mm-hmm. I said earlier that scientists and researchers from all over the world are flocking onto the continent. Is that an exaggeration? Are there different nationalities on your team?
No, it's not an exaggeration at all. When you said emerging as the new frontier, it actually already has emerged. Mm-hmm. And people just want to come here and join the excitement. As for nationalities, I've got, I have postdocs from South Africa, from France, from the United States. I've got students from Cameroon, from Mauritius. So it really is it's a very diverse team.
Is the face of science and even space exploration changing? I mean, is this a mini United Nations as opposed to the Cold War era when it was the United States and the USSR as dominant countries?
The world was bipolar and so was space exploration. But now you see India and China becoming dominant in the sphere, and you see South Africa building this wonderful instrument.
Let's talk about you, Cynthia. You're also a global citizen. You left a prestigious research position in the United States to come to Africa. Why?
For the exact same reason that Oleg said, there's a tremendous opportunity for astronomy in South Africa, with the SKA being the flagship project. But in addition to that, astrophysics has become a national priority. And so just the opportunities for research here are they're growing, and it's going to be very exciting in the future.
What does an astrophysicist do, actually?
So we do a lot of different things. Our primary goal is to study, as Oleg said, our place in the universe, how the universe works as a whole, the biggest structures, ranging from that to the smallest things like stars, planets, everything out there that it lies beyond the Earth. And so in practice, what we do is we build telescopes. We also look at data. We analyze huge volumes of it. There's a lot of math and computer science that is involved. So every day is a little bit different for us.
Your previous position was in the South Pole. Is this where you have to do the kind of work that you're doing?
It depends. A lot of the telescopes are located in very remote locations because that's where we have access to the cleanest skies. So the South Pole is one example of one of those locations. And of course, the Karoo is another excellent example, and that's where the SKA will be hosted. So both are very remote and far away places.
Oleg, let's just come back to you. The decision to host the SKA here, to locate it here in Africa, was this a good decision and why?
Well, first of all, it was during the bidding process, it became clear that South Africa has an absolutely excellent site for this telescope. So this decision was made very much for technical reasons. And I think it's a fantastic thing for South Africa and for Africa as a whole to have such a global scientific instrument here.
Fumani, just to bring it in here, from a development perspective, do you think it's a good idea to have this project located here?
Generally, yes. But I think the development question that we ought to be asking is, what does it mean for us, right? So what does it mean for us as people who belong to, rather, to whom the land belongs? What does it mean for our development? What does it mean for our progress as society? And also, you know, there's a financial question, right, associated to this. So to the extent that our fiscus is being expended on this project, that's what we need to be talking about. And that for me is the development question and the good primarily for me is in relation to that aspect.
Fumani, are you suggesting that our infrastructure and resources should be better used elsewhere?
Not necessarily. I mean, I am cautious in that regard because I'm not trying to sort of create a zero-sum picture. You know, I think there is a place for science, and science does have a place in the story of our development. I think that what's necessary for us to do, in order for all of this to be accessible, is to talk about science as just codified knowledge. That's all it is. It's just a form of knowledge, right? And this here is an expression of one strand of science, one form, you know, it's just a discipline. And I think that the more important question for us as Africans in addressing the knowledge question may not necessarily be one of, you know, sort of gazing into, you know, galactic light and trying to work out, our, you know, who we are from that perspective. I think there's a role for that, but there's probably a more important role for us to gaze into ourselves. That's the kind of science that we don't have, and that science can be coded as history, as language, but there are a lot of things about who we are that we are not investing as much in.
Professor Oleg, what's your response to that?
I think we should not forget that a project like the SKA is not just about the science that will be done by the SKA. There's perhaps even more importantly, there's a very large development component in it, because basically, when you fund a question like fund a project like that, you are answering the question: what sort of society do we want to live in 20 years from now? What sort of economy? Now, the government says they want to move South Africa to a knowledge base, to a high-tech economy. Projects like that are great for developing those sorts of capacities, because if you want to have a high-tech economy, who is going to be doing it? The people in it, they have to. Of course, the universities can train the skills and. Moving the science forward improves the universities, so that means better skills. But there's also all sorts of other people who have to contribute and who have to be challenged to build a high-tech economy. I can give you a very simple example, which just occurred to me on the way to the show. So just now in the Karoo, the foundations of the first dish of the Meerkat antenna were poured. So this is like the first tiny baby step. Even the antenna is not there, it's just the foundations. Sounds very simple, right? It's just a concrete slab on which the telescope sits. The contractors that had to do this, they are basically used to making foundations for buildings where you might be thinking in terms of units of half a brick. A telescope has to be very precise, so these guys had to pour these foundations to the precision of a micron, which was completely new for them, but they seem to have managed. And this is just the first tiny step in building a radio telescope. Now think how often this story is going to play out as the full thing is built. How many people, how many businesses will be challenged to rise above, to learn new skills.
Cynthia, what do you think? Is there a tension between our developmental aspirations and science?
No, not at all. I completely agree with Oleg's sentiment, and I'll expand on his example a little bit. Is the last time I was out in the Karoo and watching all the Meerkat action take place, there was a group of students from the Durban University of Technology who were out there and working with the scientists and learning skills that they wouldn't have otherwise received back at home at their university. So it has a very real impact on a lot of people from the ground up.
Mm-hmm. So. Fumani spoke about gazing into ourselves, our history and our cultures. And I do want to know, I mean, to what extent will this project answer questions about our universe, who we are and where we're going as mankind?
Well, I think astronomy, first of all, teaches you to be humble.
Really?
Because we really are just a tiny dot on a small rock orbiting a ball of gas. So it teaches us that our place in the universe is not special at all. But I think at the same time, it teaches us how, by the token, it teaches us how precious we are, you know, that we're actually capable of sitting on this tiny ball of rock and discussing these questions.
Mm-hmm. Is there extraterrestrial life? I think a lot of people have that question burning in their minds. You want to know what else is out there.
No, I wish I had the answer to give you. Oh. it would be wonderful if we saw some transient event that would indicate such, but we'll just have to listen and see what happens.
If I was a gambling man, I would say, yeah, I bet there is. But the universe is so big that...
There's a lot of space out
there.
Yeah,
there's a lot of space for them to...
So how much, and I know for money you'll have that question, how much does it all cost you to find all those answers to these questions? Let's talk specifically about the SKA. All fascinating stuff, very educational, but it must cost a lot of money.
Yes, it does cost a lot of money. I think the budget for phase one that's being discussed now is about 600 million euros, if I'm correct. But remember, this comes from all the international contributors, right? So only a part of that comes from South Africa, per se.
Fumani, does that comfort you somehow? I mean, I also live in South Africa where there are problems with infrastructure, with health, with education. And I am also concerned about money. But Professor Oleg is reassuring us that money is coming into South Africa. That's development, is it not?
Not necessarily, right? That's the thing. Development is not that simple. And I really want to challenge the idea that, you know, it's like looking at FDI, there's like a whole sort of dogma around that, you know, to the extent that there's money flowing into the country, that means there's development. Well, no, development is about justice, it's about equality, it's about spreading benefit, and those are the things that our state is failing at. So I don't necessarily think, and I know that the SKA is making great strides, you know, and for me, and really discussing the SKA is almost using it as a metaphor for other projects of this nature, you know. I understand it's a historical place, and I understand why, as Africans, particularly at the state level and in terms of international relations, we may see it as necessary to almost, you know, play that game, you know, and appear to grandstand, as everyone else does, really. What for me is frustrating is that there's a lack of, I think, creativity in how we think about development, right? If you go on the website currently, on the SKA website, and you ask about who the partners are, it's everyone but the community, right? So no one is even talking. And I mean, I know that it's not situated in a populous area, but the point is there are communities that are touched by it. And no one is even talking about those communities as custodians, as decision makers. So for me, there's still a lot of gaps. And that is the development question. And I feel like as South Africans, that's the thing that we should be experts at, because that's our fundamental concern.
Okay, so it's not just Fumani, but the ordinary South African, the ordinary African. Why should I, really, on the street, care then about the SKA? How do scientists like yourself convince or even persuade me that I can have a stake in the SKA and that it should matter to me?
Yeah, pure science is a wonderful vehicle for advancing technology, first of all. Pure science, you can't say that you're working towards curing cancer in medicine, for example, or in engineering, you can't say you're building the next greatest thing to solve some problem here. Pure science really is blue skies research, and pure science also has the benefit of having wonderful technological spin-offs. So one of the greatest examples of all time, I think, is the internet, which resulted from high-energy physics research. Another example is GPS, which would not be possible without general relativity that was developed by Einstein. Without those calculations that were seemingly esoteric and very abstract at the time, we wouldn't be able to know our position from that method. So it's difficult to quantify and predict the total output and impact of pure science research like that. But I think it is very valuable for any society.
And Professor Oleg, you spoke earlier about a new way of doing things, transferring of skills and so on. But how do you respond to Fumani's assertion that even on the website, the local communities are not involved?
Perhaps it doesn't come across on the website very well, but SKA South Africa runs a big public outreach program. Mm-hmm. And we try to work with schools, especially schools in underprivileged areas, to get those kids to take an interest in science.
Again, from a development perspective, there are many households in South Africa that are not lit, that do not have electricity. What are your comments on this? I mean, it's not up to the scientists to provide the electricity, to be fair, but to learn that 110 megawatts of electricity to the SKA, that's a lot of electricity. Yet, we're living in a country where many, or living in a continent for that matter, where many don't have electricity. How do you make your case stronger then?
I'm cautious to present things in terms of zero sum, you know, and you know, whether it's the national budget that we're talking about or even the power that's available to us. I think that necessarily power will be distributed in, you know, in ways that unfortunately are not equal, or not universal. The I mean, where I can come in and sort of defend the power generation side of things is just as a function of the work that I do, because I plan sort of the economic development of renewable energy projects. So I'm very aware that the state currently is investing in about over 3,000 megawatts of renewable energy. So that for me, you know, at least says that the state is doing a lot more and is aware of power as a general concern. And of course, that energy is not going to flow to the SKA, right? So it is going to flow to households in the rest of the country and is being produced in a way that is more, say, environmentally responsible. So I think that there are things that the state does understand and is more progressive on. For me, you know, the issues that I challenge are the linearity with which we think about the science question. You know, so when we say the SKA is doing outreach, again, you know, it's a very linear relationship. The SKA is at the center and will go and teach the people. And I'm saying that what we need really to make this something that is enriching is for there to be a more complex relationship, right? And more interesting relationships where even these scientists are learning from us, you know, as South Africans, as
local communities.
Local communities, you know what I mean? I feel like the framing of this whole thing as, you know, sort of the scientific community being over there and the rest is ultimately what is going to generate the problems.
Oleg, do you think South Africa has its priorities right?
I think in general, yes. Mm-hmm. I would answer, I can give you a specific example for the power question. Now, Cynthia was talking about spin-offs. One of the spin-offs of a development like the SKA is certainly lower power computing, because that's something we're spending a lot of effort on right now. Mm-hmm. We know we're going to need a lot of computers to run this thing, and we know we won't be able to afford the power unless we can make them much more, use much less. Mm-hmm. So that will be a direct spin-off of the SKA. In terms of, I would disagree with you that we are, you seem to imply that we scientists exist in a kind of a separate esoteric plane from the rest of society. It might seem that way sometimes, but that's not where we're trying to be. This is what all our outreach is about. This is, you know, we would love to involve everyone in this, and we're trying to do that. But at the end of the day, we're radio astronomers, so that's what we can teach. We're not historians, we cannot teach history.
What about the argument that for Africa it would make sense, I'm still arguing the development issue, it would make sense to invest in less prestigious but more lucrative projects like fracking, for example, and the SKA is seen as more prestigious, but fracking would be more lucrative for our development, for our energy supply. What's your comment on that?
Well, fracking is not a long-term solution to anything, right? I mean, I understand it's important to develop more energy resources, but in that sense, it's a limited application, right?
Could it be disruptive to the SKA?
If you fracked right next to it, yeah, for sure. But it's not, you know, any industrial activity next to a radio antenna is bad news, because, you know, these things are incredibly sensitive, and we're trying to pick up the faintest whispers from the universe. So anything industrial, fracking is not special in that respect.
You were nodding there earlier.
Yeah, no, I was just agreeing that, right, with fracking, it's a limited resource and it's finite. But with scientific knowledge, it is a lasting deliverable that it will, you know, once knowledge is created, it doesn't get destroyed. So,
Fumani, you spoke earlier that you're not trying to be one-dimensional and you shouldn't look at development in that way. But South Africa is not the only country that is making massive investments in these scientific projects. India is also a country that is battling with poverty, but it hasn't stopped the space exploration, including rockets to Mars. So life continues despite the poverty around us.
Look, we have to answer very fundamental questions. We have to answer moral questions about how we spend our money. And I mean, I'm very conscious of the fact that we could spend money and not achieve very much, right? And our education sector is a very great example of that, where it gets the lion's share of the budget, and unfortunately we haven't...
The results don't speak to
you. You know what I mean? So we have our responsibilities are multifold, and we have to... there's a lot more to be done than just directing money in towards certain causes. I think we need to demonstrate integrity in everything that we do, as a state and as a society, so that we're believable, right? So that when, you know, our ministers are cutting ribbons to, you know, massive telescopes, we can still believe that my counselor in my neighborhood is looking after me. That's the kind of problem that we need to solve. It's not that we don't want to move forward and be part of the global community, but it's important that we do it in terms that are, I think, honest.
Well, that address our developmental needs.
Exactly, and still connected to who we are.
Okay, so let's talk about space exploration. I spoke about the USSR and the United States, the dominant figures back during the Cold War. But is there a chance that space exploration is about power and prestige and not the real science? What's your comment to that, Cynthia?
I try not to think about the power struggle too much. I mean, I think none of us who do it for the science, those are two very different goals. And those of us who want to do it for the science, we're not interested in the power. But unfortunately, that's the way the world works sometimes, is that countries want to race to get rockets and things out into space. But those of us on the ground floor, we're interested for the exploration factor.
Professor Oleg, do you share the same sentiments, or is it about the first country to have achieved this, the first scientist to have achieved this, power and prestige?
It's partially about that, of course, but, you know, take the long view. Humanity has to go into space.
It has to. Why?
Because there is, we only have this one precious planet, and if we don't someday expand, we'll be stuck, right?
Okay, so we are a global community, but there's always one country that leads, that is further than other countries. But which countries are emerging or will emerge in the future as the leading frontiers in the space exploration?
If you ask about radio astronomy in particular, well, South Africa would be a good example.
You're not just saying that to make Afrimani happy.
No, that's, come on, look at what's happening now. It's obvious. Yeah.
That's one of the reasons I moved here.
Mm-hmm. So South Africa genuinely stands out.
Yeah, for potential in the future, absolutely, yes.
There are many other countries in the global south, India, China?
Yes. India and China are also definitely on the way there. They're also investing quite heavily in radio astronomy.
So I've got two scientists in the studio. You must be very, very excited about the recent ventures of India sending rockets to Mars. What do you make of that?
I think it's great. I mean, it's an incredibly difficult thing to do. And I think it's fantastic that a country like India is actually doing something like that now. It shows the level to which they're rising.
Cynthia, is it a big development? What do you make of it?
Yeah, absolutely. The more exploration, the better. So the more probes that we have trying to figure out what's going on out there, I'm all for it. Mm-hmm.
So Fumani, there's no going back. The SKA is here. South Africa is involved. The developmental challenges that you're talking about still remain. As governments make decisions and as scientists get on with their work in the Karoo, what would you like them to keep in mind?
For me, the fundamental thing that we need to be responding to, particularly in response to the majority of Africa's population and the rest of the global south, is the question of our epistemic confidence, right? The way in which that we have been disempowered historically has been through this particular instrument, you know, using forms of knowledge against us to then discredit what we know, how we know, and our ability to know and therefore build our own societies. I think currently what the SKA is a site that happens to be on the African continent, right? In order to be a source of knowledge, a source of something that is believable even to the outside world, well, we need to have a greater community of African scientists even working on it, right? And that's not because we want to be exclusive. Everyone is for global integration, and there's value in all of this, the Russians, the Chinese, Americans, all of it is great. But in order for it to be believable, we need our own communities to be contributing to it.
I understand what you're saying. Final comments from you, Cynthia?
Yes, I would just like to say we do have a very vibrant community of South Africans working on the project, so it is not just a plot of land by any stretch of the imagination. The SKA offices in Cape Town are brimming with people and young scientists who will eventually transform the country. So, yes, we are working in that direction.
Professor Oleg?
Yeah, I agree. I think this is exactly the question that SKA South Africa as a project was facing a few years ago. We may get the site, but what do we want this to be? Do we just want this to be a place where international scientists come to do their science, or do we want this to be something that's for South Africa? And that's why the Human Capital Development Program was established, exactly to build a community of African and South African scientists who will be using this instrument.
Well, I've loved chatting to you. Very, very fascinating. And we're sitting back and watching the developments around the SKA. Thanks, Cynthia, for joining us on South to North. Fumani, a pleasure to have you here. And Professor Oleg, a pleasure to have you on South to North. And thanks to you for watching South to North tonight. I don't know about you, but I don't think I'll ever view the stars in quite the same way again. Please don't forget to tweet your questions, comments, and opinions to @AJSouthToNorth or find us on Facebook. Do join me again on South to North next time. Until then, goodbye.